Hi, everybody. We're going to wait for maybe 2 minutes till 11:02 to get started. So stand by. Okay, it's 11:02. So we're going to get started. Welcome to our webinar, Public Speaking Hacks for Research Poster Presentations with Ms. Angie Alley. We are putting on this webinar in support of the New Mexico Research Symposium on November 5th in Albuquerque at the UNM Student Union Building. The symposium will include the Rio Grande Research Slam competition and a keynote talk by David Bustos titled Life Before the Ice Melted. Racing to preserve fossil footprints and traces of people from 23,000 years ago. It's gonna be awesome. Anyway, tomorrow at 10 a.m., well, tomorrow is the last day you can register for this in-person event. We are closing registration at 10 a.m. So if you are planning to attend, please attend or please register before 10 a.m. And again, this is an in-person event. Okay, so the plug, who am I? I'm Brittany Vandeworf. I am the Communication and Outreach Specialist for New Mexico EPSCoR, which is the established program to stimulate competitive research. EPSCoR is a nationwide program funded by the National Science Foundation. And I'll be your host for today, along with my partner in webinar crime, Ms. Isis Serna, who will be working behind the scenes to make it all run smoothly. All right. I meant to show you that earlier. This is the symposium logo and event and all of our partners. Okay, so a few housekeeping things before we begin. If you have questions at any point, please type them into the Q&A box and our wonderful presenter will answer them at the end of her talk. And then with that, sorry, it's been a while. With that, I'd like to introduce our presenter for today, Ms. Angie Alley. So Angie completed her master's degree in speech communication from Colorado State University, where she then started teaching communication. In 2012, Angie joined the CNM family as a full-time communication instructor. And since 2021, she's been serving as Interim Associate Dean in the School of Liberal Arts. So outside the classroom, Angie can be found on stage. She performs musicals and is a speaker coach for TEDxABQ. She also has an outstanding poodle named Archie, who has been known to help people with their public speaking as well. Anyway, thank you so much for being here, Angie. Please begin whenever you're ready.
Awesome. Thank you, Brittany. I do appreciate it. So this is one of those do as I say, not as I do sort of thing. I believe in standing up and presenting. However, I am sitting right now. My dog, Archie, is right here. He had an EKG, and so he's not feeling very well. So he is asking that I please have him in my lap. So for those of you who are pet parents, you'll understand. So yes, I have been teaching communication classes, particularly public speaking, for about 18 years and 10 years here at CNM. And Archie is a registered service dog for the classroom because he helps with anxiety. He helps students. He also does musical theater with me. So we just sort of come as a little pair. So thank you for that. I want to go ahead and share my screen with you because I have a really cool little presentation that I want to talk about. And I want to go over, there's several things that I would like to review today. I want to talk about, I shared the wrong screen. Hold on one second. There we go.
Beautiful.
Okay, there we go. So I really want to go through and talking about how to know your audience, how to prepare for your speech, and then basic public speaking skills. Now, I understand this is not rocket science, but public speaking is challenging. And speaking, anybody can speak, but speaking well is an art form. And there's several different elements to that. Again, knowing your audience, how to prepare, and the public speaking delivery. So those are the things that I'm going to go over. I have such a passion for public speaking. It's what gets me out of bed. So I hope that you can pick up on a couple or walk away with a few tools to put in your belt for when you public speak. Because I always tell people that unless you work in a lighthouse, you're gonna have to public speak. And it's a really essential key skill to have. So the first thing I want to talk about is how to know your audience. Well, there's a couple right and wrong ways of public speaking. Now, I hate to use the word right and wrong. There's a lot there. But there's a couple things that I don't want you to think. We are not authentic. That's not true. The greatest public speakers out there are the ones that are authentic and vulnerable. I've been a coach for TEDxABQ since 2013. And I can tell you the greatest speeches that I have seen are the ones where they are authentic, where they are themselves, and where they are vulnerable. They show emotions. Now I understand doing poster sessions, writing grants, asking for money, you can't exactly be super vulnerable, but there's a difference between vulnerability where you're crying and being vulnerable in showing who you are and your true authenticity. Because if you show your great personality, people are going to connect with you. So I want you to stop thinking, oh, this is not authentic, this is not vulnerable, because that's not true. Using big words, you've got to get rid of that. Because words, oftentimes, audiences can't relate to it. Now you might be saying, yes, but I'm speaking exactly to my audience, my people, and that's great. But oftentimes we find that our audiences are really diverse group of people. I run workshops out of Sandia National Labs. And a lot of the workshops that I do are helping people understand how to connect to their audience. So I ask them, I want you to tell me what you do in 5 words or less. And people don't like that. They're like, well, I've been studying this for 20 years and this. And I go, that's great. Tell me what you do in 5 words or less. And if they say a word that I don't know or that I think is too big, I go, nope, find another word. I'm not dumbing it down. I'm making it accessible for everybody. My husband got his PhD in inorganic chemistry. And people will ask him, well, that's great. What did you study? And he says, why plastics don't melt. That was it. And so people can go, oh, that's cool. I get that. And then they can follow up with questions. Because if you allow the space for the questions to happen, then you can engage in a great dialogue. So he studied when you're cooking and you take your good grip, your spatula, and you place it right into the skillet or boiling water, why it doesn't melt. That's exactly what he studied. And now it's accessible for all. And we talk about concepts that audience don't care about. That's not true. People are they're thirsty for knowledge. They want to know what you're doing because you are important. You are studying new things and bringing to life new ideas and new concepts. And that's what it is that we're looking for. So again, the wrong, you're not authentic, you're not vulnerable, use big words, people don't care. None of that is true. You are authentic, you bring the vulnerability, and you make it accessible for all. So what are some of the correct ways to think? Well, I took this from TED because, again, I do coach TED, but I want to give credit where credit is due. TED talks about the ABCs, audience before content, always audience before content. This captures the essence of what you are communicating about. Now, it's not about you. It's about the audience. It's about the people you are talking about. If you let the audience know, I appreciate you, I'm glad that you're here, they're going to listen to you. It's true. That's just human nature. When we're talking to people, and if we let them know, thank you for coming, let me get to know you first, then they're willing to listen to anything you have to say. It's honoring people. It's respecting people. So you need to get to know your audience first. Now, that can be challenging because sometimes your audience is just a couple people. Sometimes it might be thousands of people, but you can still find connection even with thousands of people. And I will talk about that in 1 second. Making your talk relatable, engaging, and memorable. We are also going to go through how to do that as well. So put a pin in those two. We will return to them. Continuing on, I want you to know that what you are talking about is an absolute gift. What you have to say, what you're studying, what you're presenting, that's a gift. And we want to hear it because it's important. And the best speeches are the ones where people are vulnerable and authentic, and they can make the material relatable. And I will also have a story about that one as well. And again, putting people first. When people feel engaged, they care what you have to say. If the audience knows that you care about their experience, they'll care about you. So in the classroom, it is essential for me that I know all the names of my students. Because when people know I know their name, they know I care about them. Now, am I saying that you have to know the name of all your audience members? Absolutely not. But if you have just a couple people, you need to know their name. And maybe they'll be wearing a name tag, which would be great. But you just have to let them know I care about you. Okay, again, I mentioned a couple things. We will be returning to them. But I want to talk about a couple things first. Anytime you need to go into a presentation, you need to ask yourself these questions. Why are these people choosing to listen to me speak? Well, the answer could be a whole variety of things. Absolutely. They want to know. They want to know what you have to say. What do they hope to gain from this presentation? I asked myself that when I was putting together this presentation for you. So I said, well, what do I hope they gain? Well, I hope they gain why it's important to public speak. And I hope that they gain a couple tools on how to deliver an effective and dynamic speech. So yeah, I asked myself that question and I hope that's what you gain from it. What are your expectations? Well, I'm assuming your expectations are that I am organized, that I am credible, and that I walk the walk and talk the talk. With that, I can't stand up here and go, public speaking is really important. You need to be dynamic and you need to be engaging and maybe even funny, because you're going to tune out. You are going to mute me and you are going to go someplace else. When you are expecting something, you want them to deliver. So this is a presentation about public speaking, then you expect that the speaker is passionate about public speaking and has knowledge with public speaking. That is why Brittany was so kind to read my bio beforehand so that you knew what my credibility was. Okay, I've been teaching 18 years. I coach TED Talks and I do musical theater. Now, why would musical theater matter? Because teaching is nothing more than an extension of the stage. If I teach public speaking, I better be able to do that on the stage. So again, that's where my credibility lies. And what can I say in order to meet and exceed those expectations? Well, I hope that this presentation does that. So please ask yourself those questions anytime you are about to enter into a realm of public speaking, no matter it be the poster presentation or any other presentation that you will be giving. Along the lines of asking yourself questions, you need to turn that around to the people that you are speaking to. You need to see if you can ask people questions. Now, again, this is dependent on the size of the audience. If you have 1,000 people, you can't say, does anybody have any questions? Because you might have 800 questions. But you can ask them, does this make sense? Is what I'm saying, does it make any sense? Or do I need to change what I'm saying? One of the best tools a speaker can have in their tool belt is the ability to change up what they're saying in a different way, explain it in a different way. Because sometimes it may make sense to me, but it doesn't make sense to you. So, okay, well, let me think of it this way. Let me present it this way. Let's use this metaphor. Again, my husband is an inorganic chemist, but he also is a great mathematician. And I'm trying to understand a little bit more math. I'm trying to learn calculus a little bit more. And by learning, meaning I'm doing it at home. But I say, I don't understand this. Can you put it in a different way? And he'll say, yeah, okay. So I'm also a tennis player. So he'll say, okay, let's picture you're on the court and you're doing this. And all of a sudden I'm, okay, I get that. So it's helping to understand what it is that your audience can connect to. And do you have any questions? Obviously, that's a great way to ask questions and to engage with your audience. However, I want to talk about the golden improv rule, the yes and the no but. Improv is really important. And if you've ever heard of an actor named Alan Alda, he has a wonderful connection with teaching STEM courses through improv. It's wonderful and it's brilliant. And he has a book and it's just great. So improv really is important when it comes to teaching STEM and public speaking, because you want to engage with your audience. You want to have a connection. You want to build communication. So by saying yes and no, but you build connection, you fuel curiosity, and that's where communication happens. So let me give you an example of what I mean by yes and or no, but. So let's say you're at a poster presentation and an audience member or comes up to you and asks you a question and the answer is yes. And you simply say yes. The conversation is dead. It's not going to go anywhere. In order to fuel curiosity through your audience and fuel connection, you need to say yes and, which means you follow up with information. Yes and X, Y, and Z. A very, very, very simple example is, man, it's hot outside. Yes, and my AC is broken. Oh, well, I'm sorry to hear that one about this. Now all of a sudden the conversation has been engaged because you want to engage in conversation with an audience member. You can do the same for no. If an audience member asks you a question and you go, no, again, the conversation is dead and it's not going to build or go anywhere. So you have to say no, but. So a simple example is, man, it's cold outside. No, but I'm from Alaska. Okay, great, great. That leads us to our next bullet point, which is listen for free information. Free information is what the audience member is going to give you. And you have to listen to that. And then you build your questions and your communication and your conversation off of that. So going back to it, we say, no, but I'm from Alaska. Well, the free information is Alaska. So you say, oh, well, where in Alaska are you from? How do you like Albuquerque? How's the desert treating you? Again, that curiosity fuels conversation, fuels communication. And that's where you make connections with your audience. You listen for free information for what it is they're saying, and you follow up with questions, and then they'll talk, and then they'll come back to you with questions. Yes and no but is one of the greatest tools you can have in your tool belt when it comes to engaging with your audience. All right, so here's some snappy tips that we're gonna talk about that we'll follow up again with the things that I said we would follow up with. Facts tell and stories sell. I can't tell you how much of a mantra, how much I love this mantra. Because you've got to make your presentations engaging, funny, memorable. Facts, you can tell facts all day long. It's boring. I mean, we care, but how much can we really connect with facts? Stories is what sells. Stories is what engages us. It's where we find commonality. So whatever it is that you are presenting on, think about a story. It could be a personal story, or it could be a story that you researched and you found. Now, these stories cannot go on and on and on. They got to be short. You got to get in there. You got to sell it. We'll talk about where you can incorporate stories in a few minutes. But some of the best places to incorporate a story is right at the beginning of your speech, right as the attention getter, because that's what grabs us. They often say, do not ever start with data. Start with stories. And by they, I mean researchers, you know, the great researchers by they. So let me tell you a quick story. A couple of years ago, I had the wonderful opportunity to coach a young man from NASA for his TED Talk. And he had the incredible, unbelievable job of building a robot to send to Mars, because we want to make sure that we want to put humans on Mars. So this robot's going, she's going to send them off to Mars and they're going to do all this and they're going to set this up and that's great. And when he was done with his speech, I told him kindly, that was really boring. And he said, well, it's my whole research, my career. And I said, yeah, I know, I get that. But I had nothing to connect to. So I said, you've been working with a robot. Let's give this robot a name. And he said, well, okay, that's fine. So we ended up naming the robot Suki. And I said, can you bring the robot to the TED Talk? And he said, yeah, that's fine. So as he said, I want to tell you about Suki. And then he brought Suki onto the stage. All of a sudden now I have something to connect to, because Suki was adorable. This tiny little robot, all of a sudden I cared about it. And we redesigned his speech to tell me what Suki does to prepare to go to Mars, what Suki does on the 9 months to Mars, and what does Suki do when we get there. And the reason why we built it that way is because each of you have taken a trip and each of you do something to prepare, what you do during your journey and what you do when you're there. It's relatable. So he told us all the things that Suki has to do to prepare to go to Mars. Then he told us all the things that she has to do on her way to Mars. And then he told us, when she got to Mars, here's what she did. And I was invested. I cared about Suki's success. And that was it. That was the story he told. So we wove the story throughout his data and the information that he wanted to let us know. More about stories to come here in a few minutes. The curse of knowledge. Oof, that's a big one. All of you are so intelligent, so ambitious, and bring so much to the table, and you just want to tell us everything. Don't do that. It overwhelms the audience. You do not want to fire hose your audience. Your intelligence is not questioned. You just want to give us bite-sized knowledge. Going back to the example with my husband, I told you that he studied why plastics don't melt. Well, he could use all those big words and tell us all sorts of stuff, and I wouldn't be that impressed. But he just gave us a nugget, why plastics don't melt. And then all of a sudden, people started asking questions, and he gave a little bit more, and he gave a little bit more. Teachers, instructors, I suffer from this all the time. When students ask me a question, I want to give them all the answers and give them the background and everything they need to know. They don't want to know that. They just want to know the answer to their question. Now, again, that's hard. It's hard to distill it down to a bite-sized nugget. But that's the challenge for you. All right. I want to address the elephant in the room. Public speaking anxiety. I get it. Speaking is a very anxious thing. And it's real. More people, when it comes to funerals, more people would rather be in the casket than give the eulogy. Now, Jerry Seinfeld came up with that. That's a quote from Jerry Seinfeld, but I think it really encapsulates the anxiety that people feel. Anxiety around public speaking is real. So I spend a whole week on this in my class, and I say, why are you anxious? And these tend to be the real leading reasons. Fear of rejection. Well, I can tell you in my classroom, or anytime I go and listen to someone speak, there's no rejection. I really want to hear what they have to say. I wouldn't be there if I didn't want to hear them. So you know that you will not be rejected. You will be embraced. People want to hear what you have to say. Fear of failure. There's no failure in public speaking. If you show up and you talk, you are already successful. There is no failure. Center of attention. That's a big one. A lot of people don't like that. All the eyes are on them. But that's where the trick of the questions that we just talked about, that's where that comes in. If I can turn the tables and ask questions back to you, now the attention is on you. And then you, the speaker, you can listen for the free information. And not all the eyes are on you, they're on somebody else. Asking questions takes the pressure off of you. Oftentimes we're nervous about our physical reactions. There is nothing you can do about the physical reaction. Some people are like, well, my cheeks get really red and I get red on my neck and on the top of my chest. There's nothing you can do about that. No one in the audience is going to go, mm-mm, their face is red. I don't trust what they have to say. No. No. Judge you for the physical reaction that you are having. So just embrace it. Your cheeks are going to get red. They're going to get red. That's okay. Well, my palms get sweaty. Well, unless you touch your hands to people's faces, they don't know that your palms are sweaty. Well, my heart is beating. Well, we hope your heart is beating. That's a good thing. So just embrace that your body is going to have physical reactions. And in fact, you want them to have physical reactions. I have performed in 43 musicals. I just wrapped on Sunday my 43rd musical. I still get nervous. My stomach has the butterflies. I breathe shallowly, that's not a word. I have shallow breathing. I want that because if I don't have that, then the adrenaline doesn't drive me forward. So don't think of the physical reactions as a bad thing. Think of it as a positive thing. My body is preparing me to do this awesome thing. Forget what you're talking about. Well, maybe you will. And that's okay. Most of the time when you're public speaking, you're going to have your notes and you can say, oh, excuse me. Oh, there I am. Okay. You can always look at your notes. I have forgotten what I've said many times. I've forgotten it on stage. A couple weeks ago when I was performing, I forgot where I was. I forgot my line. So I just started making some things up until I figured out where we were and then off I went. But no one in the audience knew. You never tip your hand to your audience. You have all the power. So just remember that. And never, ever, ever, ever say, I'm sorry. Because more times than not, the audience, if you say, I'm sorry, the audience has no idea why you're saying, I'm sorry. And they're going to stop listening to what you're saying because they're going to go, well, what are they sorry about? What happened? What did I miss? So if you trip up on your words or you forget what you're saying, all you need to say is, excuse me. That's all. And catastrophic thinking, you've got to escape that. We think everything under the sun is going to go wrong. Well, guess what? It might, but it probably won't. Anything that you're thinking that's going to go terribly wrong probably will not happen. Now, I've been teaching many years and I've been doing performances and I've seen a lot of things and things have happened to me, but the worst things I can think of still have yet to happen. So please put that aside. And finally, you never look as nervous as you feel. I always think of people like ducks when they're swimming so beautifully up on top of the water, but they're paddling like heck underneath. Their little legs are going, they're going, they're going, but we don't see that. They seem calm up on the top. So trust yourself. Trust how you present yourself because you are never look as nervous as you feel. Water, by the way, take water with you. If you are feeling nervous, you are feeling anxious, you can stop and take a drink of water. Nobody in the audience is going to go, mm-mm, they're drinking water. Nope. No, I don't trust what they have to say anymore. No one is going to think twice of it. So water can be your best friend. All right. More about public speaking anxiety. How do you prepare to public speak when your anxiety is going? Well, you can do mental preparations. Focus on the message rather than yourself. Remember, people want to hear what you have to say. And be realistic about the experience and what's at stake. Again, you have the catastrophic thinking, oh my gosh, everything is going to go wrong. This is all going to be terrible. That's probably not realistic. At the same time, you're not going to go, I'm going to get a Nobel Peace Prize for this exact talk, and the president's going to want to talk to me, and they're going to erect a statue of me. Probably not realistic either. You've just got to be realistic about what the experience is or what the setting is that you are stepping into. Mentally, you also got to think of it as like a sport. I said I play tennis. Right before my tennis matches, I don't go, well, I am going to fail. I'm going to hit every ball out. I'm going to run into the net. I'm going to forget all the rules, and it's just going to be terrible. No, I think I'm practically one of the Williams sisters. I'm like, yeah, this is great. I'm an amazing tennis player. You pump yourself up. It's no different for pumping yourself up for a speech. Physical preparation is also important. Before you, about 24 hours before you speak, eat a lot of protein. Have some pasta. Those things are important. Sugar will just make you jittery, and you'll be like, yeah, let's go. Not cool. You got to have protein and some carbohydrates. That's what it is that you need. Sleep well. Now, again, that's easier said than done because you might just lie awake and think about your speech the whole night, but do your best to get your sleep. Wear comfortable clothes. This is a big one because people think they need to look a certain way. No, you need to be yourself. Wear an outfit that brings you confidence. Wear shoes that are comfortable. Because if you are uncomfortable, it will show. Wear something that brings confidence. And try stretching. I am sitting and normally I would be standing, so forgive me. The poodle dictates the rules. But stretching is a big one. You've got to lift that diaphragm. Anytime I'm about to go on stage or give a speech, I always stretch, because it just lifts everything up and it helps with your diaphragm. So moving will always help. For more preparation, knowing the venue is really important. Knowing the circumstances and your audience, if you can, who am I speaking with? I did the same here. I asked Brittany, well, who am I speaking to? Where? What are they doing? What do they want to know? It's important that I know who's in my audience. And you have got to arrive early. And early is not just 5 minutes. Try 15, 30 minutes. Sometimes I arrive an hour early because I just need to walk around. I need to know the venue. I need to know where water is, where the bathrooms are, where the exits are. Whatever you need to know that will make you comfortable. Because if you are arriving late, your anxiety is high and therefore you are not prepared. So knowing contextual preparation is really important. CNM just had their donor dinner on Tuesday and I coached the three student speakers. I made them get there 2 hours early because I wanted them to practice walking up the stairs onto the stage. I wanted them to practice with the podium, with the mic, and how loudly to speak so that the whole ballroom could hear them. That was important. There's lights on them. There's people eating, table noises. There's lots going on. So know your space. And there's speech preparations. Please do not procrastinate. That is really the kiss of death for the speaker. My students will tell me, well, I'll know what to say when I get up there. And I'll go, nope. You have to write out your speech. You have to do it. Well, I'll practice it when I get there. Nope. And we'll talk about that here in a second. So practicing beforehand in the setting is really important. And recording yourself is important. I will talk about practicing here in a second. There is a fantastic TED Talk that Amy Cuddy gives, and it's about nonverbal communication. And she often says, fake it until you become it. And that's a really important one. She talks about what your body language says about you as you speak. It's a longer video. That's why I didn't share it, but I wanted you to look at it. It's just a TED Talk and she is fantastic in it. All right, more preparation. timing is everything. Comply with the time limits. It is astounding to me how people will say, I need you to speak for X amount of minutes, and they just either go way under or way over. Being not within the time limits shows to me you didn't practice, you didn't put any thought into it. So if you know your time limit, honor that time limit. Public speaking requires memory. That's why you practice, which we'll talk about here in a second. Practicing your lines, practicing sections. You will start memorizing your speech. The more you practice, the more you will memorize. And that helps. When you are giving a speech, if you are not glued to your notes like this, all of a sudden you can connect with the audience. But if you don't practice, you're going to have to look at your notes and you're going to spend the whole time looking at your paper. There's no connection there. So like all communication, public speaking has content and relationship. And I hope you've picked up on that. I talk a lot about how to connect with the audience. You've got to connect with your audience. Now it's hard being on Zoom right now, but I have thrown out some free information about myself. I'm a poodle mom. I do theater. I play tennis. I'm married. I'm an educator. And I hope one of those you have connected with and you go, oh yeah, okay, I play tennis. Or I'm a pet mom, a pet parent. I get that. Relationships are important within public speaking. You absolutely want to build on your strengths and avoid your weaknesses. I don't like the word weakness. I tend to say glows and grows. You know, the glows are the things that you're really strong at. The grows are areas that we can learn more. But there are things that I avoid with speaking because I don't have the knowledge on it. I'm not very good at it. So I want to make sure to highlight my glows. And remember the power of story. We're going to talk a little bit more about that. All right. The next I want to talk about is just how to prepare for your speech. You never, ever want to wing your speech. Now, you are content experts. You know this information. But just because you know it doesn't mean you can wing it. I've been teaching public speaking 18 years. But I still put together presentations so that I have a roadmap as to where I'm going. Now, if you notice at the beginning of my presentation, I told you my roadmap. I said, we're going to talk about how to prepare. We're going to talk about your public speaking anxiety. We're going to talk about delivery skills. It is important that your audience has a roadmap as to what you're going to do, because if they know what you're going to talk about, then they're more willing to listen. So the best way to compose the introduction for your speech is having a strong sense of the body of your speech. So before we get to the body, we have to have the introduction. Well, how do you do that? Well, there's five different ways that you can have the introduction. You want to grab the audience's attention. Well, what's the best way to do that? Tell a story, ask questions. You want to establish your credibility. Again, Brittany did that for me at the beginning of this speech. I wasn't just some random person off the streets to be asked to public speak. I have credibility around the public speaking, and the audience wants to know that. That is essential. That is important. You want to establish the rapport. Let people know, I want to be here. This is important to me. Review your topic and preview your main points. That is very important to the introduction of your speeches. If you do those five things, you will set yourself up for success. It doesn't matter what kind of presentation you are doing. All right, one more. I said stories. That is the anecdotes. That is the narratives. Those are so important, but it has to be short. I told you the story about Suki. That was a short story. I always start speeches with a quick story because it's fun. And I often put in humor. Because I find that if the audience is laughing, they're going to lower their defenses and they're more willing to listen to you. Again, it can be personal, but sometimes people don't want to do that, and that's just fine. So you can pick historical or current or literary sources. That is just fine. But something that we all can connect with. Now, it's got to be relevant. It can't just be some random story. It's got to connect to what it is you're saying. Now, oftentimes, very smart public speakers will tell a story and the audience will go, I I have no idea what this has to do with it. But then they bring it all back together. Brilliant. Be sure you are in control of your emotions. Now, what does that mean? Emotions are important. I do not want you to be robots, but we've got to have a sense of energy and humor, but not have it be out of control. So then, more when it comes to the introduction of your speech, you can ask the rhetorical questions, the questions that don't necessarily have an answer. You're just throwing it out. You can have startling facts or statistics. That always grabs people's attention. 100% of us are going to die. Okay, well, that makes sense. That's a fact. But it's funny and it'll get people thinking. Immediate reference to objects or purpose. You can talk about that as well. If for your poster session, if you have props, you can bring reference to them. It takes the attention off you. It takes it right onto them. Reference the audience. We talked about that. You can reference historical events. You can use humor. You can use quotations. Now, humor is a tricky one because sometimes a speaker will try to be funny and it doesn't go over well. So you have to know yourself well. Am I a humorous person? Can I pull off humor? Yes or no? That's up to you to decide. All right. Now you have the body. So we went from the introduction right to the conclusion, but that's because the body of your speech is what it is you're talking about. Remember, you always have that roadmap where you, the roadmap, the preview your main points. I like to build my speech around three main points. That's a big TED talk concept, because the brain can remember three things. Three is a very important number when it comes to public speaking, because our brain can absolutely absorb that. So preview your three main points, and it's always best if you put it around three main points. So then we're going to jump to the conclusion. You have to signal the end of your speech. You can say, in conclusion, finally, to wrap up, to summarize. And then you want to restate those three main points, or however many points you have. You always want to summarize. In public speaking, the golden rule is tell us what you're going to tell us. Tell us. And then tell us what you told us. Pretty formulaic, but it works every time. And then you want to provide a clincher, something that's memorable, or a call to action, something that they can leave with and say, yes, that's what I'm going to do. Yes, that's what I learned. So when it comes to the introduction, the body, and the conclusion, there's some important don'ts. In your introduction, do not ramble. And that can actually be said for the entire speech. How many of you have ever heard a speech and they just start going off? They go off in the woods somewhere and you think, where are we going? You always have to have purpose and direction. So never start your talk as you're approaching the lectern, the platform, the stage, whatever. You know, people are walking and they say, hi, everybody. No. You have to have yourself planted, look at the audience, and then you talk. Don't talk too fast, but don't talk too slow either. Now, one of the best things you can do when it comes to public speaking is you can talk a little fast and then you can bring it back. The dynamic is what engages the audience. It's a flow, it's a movement, it's like a dance. You want to keep them on their toes, but talking too fast is really disrespectful to you, because what you have to say is important and we want to hear what you have to say. And if you are speaking too quickly, then the audience doesn't hear it and they lose out on what you have to say. So think about the pace in which you are talking. Reading your introduction. You do not want to get up there and go, hi, my name is Angie and here's what we're going to talk about today. You already lost your audience. Eye contact is vital at the beginning of your speech. And try not to sound too pedantic, too lectury. I am a huge fan of the podcast Star Talk with Neil deGrasse Tyson. And he always, his little tagline is your personal astrophysicist. I love space. I don't know anything about it. And I want to learn as much as I can. And I like his podcast because I don't think it's pedantic. He talks in a way that I can understand. He takes really hard concepts and puts it in a way that I can understand it. So think about always how can what you're saying connects with the audience. And it goes back to what I was saying. Tell me what you do in 5 words or less. Some other important don'ts is with the conclusion. Signaling the end more than once. You don't want to, you know, tease your audience. You're going to say it's coming to an end. It's going to come to an end. You never want to bring up new material at the end. That's annoying. We want to always review what it is that we talked about. And again, with that rambling, that is the hardest thing. People know that the speech is coming to an end. The speakers do. And they don't exactly know how to, they don't know how to end it. So they just keep talking. And, eventually they'll bring it to an end. Oh, you've got to just wrap it up. You have said what you've said and get move on. And never talk as you leave the platform either. And make faces. You've got to end your speech, and then when you are done, walk away. Again, not rocket science, but it's very funny how a lot of people keep talking as they are leaving the stage. All right, I now want to move on to how to practice, because my friends, you're gonna have to practice. You can't practice in your head. You have to practice. Practice makes it permanent. As I mentioned a couple minutes ago, it's the muscle memory. You want to feel comfortable. Okay, I've said this before. Okay, this feels comfortable. Okay, I understand this. Practice only makes perfect if you practice perfectly. I love that. What that means is you practice your speech as though you're going to give it. Oftentimes I'll put the clothes on that I know I'm going to wear. So I know how that feels. I will stand up. I will do it in front of people so that I can see their responses. I will record myself. Practice only makes perfect if you practice perfectly. Practice your speech beforehand at home, anywhere, especially in front of audiences. Ask people to listen to your speech and time your speech. Because again, we talked about timely is important. So understand how that feels in front of live people. More on how to practice. Practice out loud in your full volume. Don't just sit there in your room and kind of, you know. No. You want to do it loud. And you have to stand up. You cannot practice your speech as you are sitting down. Again, don't do what I'm doing, which is sitting. You have to stand up. You have to feel that energy in your body. Practice with the lectern or something that's close by. And we're going to talk about the lectern. We're going to talk about how important that is. And practice with an audience, please. Any audience, family, friends, anybody. Practice your speech for time and practice recording yourself. Now, I get it. Nobody likes to watch a recording of themselves. I get it. But you have to, because there's things that you are doing that you aren't aware you are doing. And we're going to talk about that in a few minutes. All right. Going back to recording yourself. We all have tics and we need to be aware of those tics. I tend to play with my necklace or play with my ring. So if I know I have a big presentation, I don't play with my wedding ring, but I play with this ring. I will remove my ring and I remove my necklace because I know I have a tic and I will practice. I will play with them. Now, I'm not nervous, but if people see me playing with jewelry, they will think she's nervous and I'm not. So I'm removing the temptation. That's why recording yourself is important so that you can see what tics you have that you may not have been aware of. All right, on to the last part of this presentation is the delivery. How you deliver your speech is key. Effective delivery is important. You have to have enthusiasm. If you talk about paint drying, with enthusiasm, your audience is going to say, man, paint drying is fantastic. I had no idea. You have to have passion. If you do not have passion, do not talk about it. I love public speaking. The passion you see is genuine because I want people to understand how important public speaking is. Your facial expressions. So much of what you say is in your face. It's in your eyes. It's in your cheeks. It's in your mouth. What you are saying. If you go along the lines of saying, well, that was just the best day of my life, I'm going to say, was it? Because I don't believe it. If you're going to say that was the best day of my life, you need to have facial expressions. You need to smile. Now, that's uncomfortable for a lot of people. I told you I run workshops at Sandia. One of the things that I do is I have them read children's books. Engineers, scientists, I have them read children's books. Now, why? Because when you read a children's book, you need to have the dynamics, the engagement, vocal variety, facial expressions, enthusiasm. Because if you read a children's book to a child in your monotone, they'll tell you so. So you gotta have vocal variety. You have to have gestures. We're gonna talk about that. You gotta move. Now, keep in mind, your movement has to have purpose. Don't just stand up there on stage and walk back and forth. Can't do that. You got to move with purpose. And if you're going to move and you stop and then you talk and then you move again. And then you have to have eye contact, which we'll talk about. So let's dive into a couple of these. Hands, your gestures are important. Now make sure that they're natural. Don't be like, welcome. That's not natural. If you feel it, do it. Your hands are important, but you're also not a penguin. When you gesture, don't just do this. Open yourself up. Gestures should be large for the audience. And if you're not gesturing, place them on the side of the lectern. Don't put them in your pockets. Put them in next to the lectern. And be mindful of the excessive energy coming through your hands because you want to do this. That's very distracting. Make sure that your gestures are natural. Your feet, your posture, that's important. Do not lock your knees. You will pass out. I have seen it before. Keep it nice and loose. Keep your feet about shoulder width apart and have that firm foundation. Don't be twisting. Don't be moving your feet around. I mean, unless you walk, but when behind the lectern, it's too easy to lean funny or do weird things with your knees and your feet. Roll your shoulders back. Look confident. If you're like this, no one's going to take you seriously. Always have your shoulders back. Your lectern is not a part of the skeletal system. It's just there to support you. Objects. Only bring to the lectern what you absolutely need. Oftentimes people will bring pens and they click it. No, you can't have that. Only bring water and your speech. That's about all I encourage you to bring. But be mindful of that jewelry. I told you my story about my ring. We fidget with jewelry. We fidget with hair. We fidget with our clothes. Your clothes aren't going anywhere. You don't need to play with them. Keep them, leave them be. And again, we talked about comfortable shoes. That do not overthink that. That is very, very important. If you are comfortable, then you will present yourself as comfortable. All right, again, the lectern, just use it for the notes. It is not for leaning, for tipping, for hugging, for gripping. You got it. Just be cool. I don't even like lecterns because as far as I'm concerned, that is an object that is it's preventing me from connecting with the audience. So if I'm giving a speech and I have a lectern, I stand to the side of it. I never stand behind it because a lectern is hiding and I don't ever want to hide myself from the audience. I want to be authentic and vulnerable. And so therefore I just have the lectern there for my notes and my water. Eye contact, it's really important. Now, depending on the size of your audience, changes how you have eye contact. If it's just a couple people, you need to look at them, but only spend about 5 seconds per person. You don't want to stare them down. But if I'm in a big auditorium, I make eye contact with the exit sign. The exit sign's not going anywhere and it's not judging me, but I'm looking, and so the audience thinks I'm looking at them. So I'll look at various different exit signs, and that's pulling the attention to various groups. and they think I'm looking at them. I'm not. I'm just looking at the exit sign. But you have to balance between right and left, back and front, so that everybody thinks they're looking at them. But just don't stare down one person. It makes them very nervous. But it does take practice. Eye contact does. Vocal variety, that is just key. We talked about it before. You have to speak up. What you have to say is important. The pitch is the high and the low. I talked about variety when it comes to the rate. You speak fast, you speak slow. You do the same with your pitch. You go high, you go low. It's, and everybody can do it. So don't think that you don't have the ability to do that, because you have pitch in your voice. And that brings the dynamics to your speech. Pauses are important. Pauses allows the audience to absorb what it is you're saying, because you're going to be given a lot of information. So they need to have the right and the chance. I'm absorbing the information. Okay. Because they might want to ask questions. Now, what I encourage you to stay away from is those vocalized pauses, otherwise known as the ums, uhs, likes, and the worst, you know. Oftentimes speakers will say, well, you know, I got up this morning and, you know, I went to Starbucks and, you know, I had my coffee and then, you know, I got to work. I don't know because I wasn't there. You know is a dangerous phrase that we fall back on. Listen to anybody speak anywhere around you and listen for how many ums and uhs and likes they say, and it will start bugging you. Oftentimes when you leave a speech, you go, that speech. I don't really know why, but I liked that speech because they didn't have any vocalized fillers, the vocal fillers. Please remove the likes, the ums, the you knows. And that's why recording yourself is important. And never, ever start your speech by going, You got to just jump right in. Remember, practice is important. There is no substitute for practicing. And your energy is important. The energy in your voice, the energy in your physical presence, and your energy to have the desire and the passion to communicate. Ultimately, my friends, I want you to go forth and be fabulous. Public speaking is a gift. What you have to say is a gift. What you have to say is important. And I hope you gathered a couple key elements, key tools in this presentation, whether that be how to practice, how to organize your introduction or your conclusion, or any sort of delivery, key delivery. Public speaking's great, and I'm excited for what it is you are doing. And I want to thank you for allowing me to come and share my passion about public speaking with you. And I wish you luck, and go forth and be fabulous.
That was wonderful. I'm just going to go for it. It looks like we have one question. That's a really good question. And I'll read it out loud. And if you could address it in this last minute, we might go maybe 2 minutes over. But here's the question. Do you have any tips for how to mentally prepare ourselves for the microphone? I hate hearing my own voice.
No one likes to hear their own voice. Do not speak really closely to the mic because it's very loud. So I usually do two, one, you know, this, and then two. And if I have two lengths of this, that's about the right distance. So just speak clearly. The mic is, I'm using this as a mic. Okay. The mic is there only to support you. It is your job to speak loudly. The mic's just there to amp it. You can't rely on that totally. And again, no one likes the sound of their voice, but you have a lovely voice.
Awesome. That was wonderful. I speak for all of the people who are muted. That was wonderful. Thank you so much, Angie. So I wanted to close this out really quick. Let's all give a round of applause, silent round of applause to Angie. Thank you so much for your time and your expertise. And on behalf of everyone who is putting together the New Mexico Research Symposium and the team at New Mexico EPSCoR, I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you. I also want to thank my partner in webinar crime, Ms. Isis Cerna. Anyway, like Angie said, go forth and be fabulous. And thank you, thank you, thank you, Angie.
Yay, my pleasure. My pleasure. Thank you so much.
Have a great day, everyone.
Bye.